Prima's redesigned chalk paste is an interesting product. It works beautifully as both a paste and a paint for your art journals and mixed media projects. In today's video, I'll show you options for backgrounds and more, and as you'll see, it even pairs well with ink sprays and other media. Today I'm working with our 3x5 and 4x6 watercolor index cards, the brand new 4x6 black index cards, plus number 8 watercolor tags, and the also very brand new number 8 black tags. The number 8 black tag measures 6 1/4 inch long, so I have trimmed these. I've trimmed that 1/4 inch off so that these tags are exactly the same height as this 4x6 index card. Though I'm going to use different sizes in the journal, and you'll see that in a minute, having these be 1/4 inch longer just felt a little awkward to me, so I decided to go ahead and leave it the way that it was, or rather cut it down the way that I have to the 6 inches. So here is the journal in its current incarnation. This is my cover, and you can see as I page through here, there are in fact smaller index cards. You can see some of the pages are a little bit further along than others, but it's absolutely perfect, except for the fact that that might be an upside down, but you didn't hear that from me. It's fine. I can live with it the way it is. But you can see that all of this works really well. This paint is super flat. It dries to a very flat finish. And yes, you are seeing glitter in here. I'm going to show you this a little bit later on. I'm using the Cosmic Shimmer Sparkle Shakers. My motto is life is short, eat dessert first, and use glitter as much as you want. I think it works. If you don't want to use it, then by all means don't. But I like the way that this looks. Very, very flat. Pens work on it. It's amazing stuff for all intents and purposes. One of the first things that you'll know when I open, or you'll notice rather, when I open a jar is that the product is really, really thick. And because it is, you can scrape it through a stencil the same way that you would gesso or gel medium. But what you'll notice once this dries and you start to play with it is that it doesn't act like a resist like gesso or gel medium does. It just dries flat, and someplace in here there's a couple of tags that have been sprayed. It comes, in fact, here's one right here. So I just sprayed some dilutions through an ink spray through a stencil. Doesn't beat up, doesn't do anything like that. So this is a very different animal. I find it very interesting. So you can layer your sprays right over the top of your chalk paint. So this stuff is, you can work with it in the same way that you would any kind of paint. It's just very, very thick. So if you like a thinner body paint, put some out on your work table or on a palette, and then go ahead and thin it with a little bit of water. I mean, you can't make paint any thicker than the way it comes out of the jar. But when you have something like this that's really super thick and super opaque, you can transition that downward a little bit if you want. So I'm going to work with some dusty plum and Buxton blue. Now inside each of the jars is this lid that I think goes a long way towards stopping the paint from drying out really quickly. When you have stuff in a wide mouth jar, that can happen some of the time. I'm not going to put a ton out because I'm just going to show you one quick technique how I apply this stuff with a brush, and then we'll move on to some other ones. So there is the dusty plum, and then here comes the Buxton blue. So for all intents and purposes, I'm working with purple and teal. Perfect to work together with. They're right next to each other, or ish, on the color wheel, so I know blending these is not going to cause me to get anything muddy going on. So let me just wipe my hands off for 1 second. All right, so these are some samples. Before I get into this, these are some samples done with the same technique with just bristles from a brush. You can see that in some cases it's kind of light and feathery, and you can really see the texture from the bristles. Or in other cases, this is much heavier. You see much less of that black background showing through. Both of them are effective. You can still see the brush strokes, but it gives you a very different look. So the nice thing is that you can get a different result depending on how you apply this. So I'm just going to use, this is probably a 1-inch brush. It's a little bit damp because I used it just a moment ago. I just want to make sure I can take out as much of the liquid as possible. I'm going to start with the dusty plum, and I'm not going to overload the brush because I want to show you how light and airy these can be. These strokes can be. You know what? That blended like that. Let's go with it and see what happens. Let's kind of brush blend like this. And so you can see you get this really cool effect. Turn this back this way. And I'm not even watering the paint down at this point. I'm just going with it the way that it is and enjoying the effect that I get from that. You see how easy that is. Now here's some wet paint here. When I have this out for a while, one of the things that you might notice me do is just very lightly miss this. Because it's so thick, it starts to skin over relatively quickly, but there's ways to work around that, and the easiest one is to simply go ahead and mist it a little bit. So you can see that this is a really simple technique to do. It's very effective, and it works whether you're working on the black, or if I come in here and I bring in one of the white index cards, and I can do the same kind of thing here. So if I want to thin this with a little bit of water, let's put some water out here, and I want to loosen this paint up a little bit, you can see that it almost becomes wash-like. If I want to do that, it's just a matter of how much paint do I want to add to get that look. And now you can see that I've lost a lot of the brush strokes, more or less. You don't see it in quite the same way as you do here, but your options are wide open with this, whether you use it straight from the jar or you thin it out a little bit. So that's our first background technique, where the paint is just haphazardly applied with a brush. If you watch enough of our videos, you've seen me use my adaptation of Tim Holtz's Distress Wrinkle-Free technique as a background technique. It's one that I use quite frequently. I'm actually going to use that here as the second one. Instead, I'm going to start with a brayer, and I'm going to show you how I use the wrinkle-free technique to mop up what's left when I'm through brayering. So these are all examples of how you can brayer paint on. It's very haphazard, gives you a very loosey-goosey kind of background, which appeals to me. So I'm going to work with three more colors. This time I'm going to work with Roycroft Rose, Water Drops, and a color named Gravel. So you can kind of see the colors here. This is a lighter, pretty color, pale kind of pink, a pale kind of green. All right, so Roycroft Rose, let's peel this out of here. Get some of that out. Now I need to kind of put this in a place where it's center so that you can see it. I'll just put that there. But then at the same time, it's going to give me enough room to work. So it's always kind of straddling that bridge between so you can see it and not giving myself any place to work. Okay. Again, super, super thick paint, but boy, does it work really well. I'm so pleased that I tried this. All right. And finally, the gravel, which is a nice gray color. It works well as a blender. It just is a good color. All right, so let's kind of spread that over there. And then let me get rid of all of these and my palette knife. So I have one of the Ranger brayers. This is the small version. Let's grab something, some surfaces to work on. So here is a couple of black tags. Here's a 3x5 index card, and I'll bring in a 4-inch index card. When I do these, I kind of work in a series. I want to do things to them all at once, so I create more than one thing at a time. So I don't want complete coverage on the brayer, and you can see that when I start to apply it, I'm going in different directions, and I'm not covering the whole surface with the brayer, because that's not my goal. I don't want that kind of a depth of coverage. I just want a little bit here and a little bit there. And you can see, let me hold this up. See that funny little edge that looks like fingers, but help if you could see it. See that little edge right there that looks like fingers on a comb? That just happens when you very loosely put the color on the brayer. So again, let's slide this over here so now you can actually see what I'm doing. All right, so that's fine. None of these colors are going to make mud. I am going to just briefly wipe some of the pink off. There's not really enough on here to worry about. Now I'm going to go into the Water Drops color. Again, same kind of thing. I'm going to go thick in spots, which allows me to get some visual texture, but it also physically makes texture on the piece. So it looks, you can see that texture along and feel it along with seeing it when you just look. All right, so there's that. And now let's go ahead and bring in some of the gray. I'm just going to use this as a little bit of an accent here and there. I don't necessarily feel like I want to cover all of this. And nothing says that I can't make a layer on top of what I already did. That just kind of makes things interesting. All right, so let's get this out of the way and then come back and do that. Now when I do these, I'm generally going to work on both sides. I want to give this enough time to dry, but then I want to come back and work on the other side. Now for the sake of argument, I don't really have enough time here to do that because this does need some time to dry, so we'll just grab some new stuff. So that's the brayer. That's how simple the whole brayering process is. I'm going to set that out of the way, and now I'm going to grab, here's where my fingers come in, I'm going to start spreading this paint out. And then I'm going to grab some other tags and things. Let's get this pink over here. I'm going to grab some other tags so that I can start this wrinkle-free thing. So when I do this, what I like to do is just take, press, and tap with whatever's left. And again, you see all this really cool random texture that happens. Oh, I like the gray and that water droplets together. It looks really cool. You know what? I think I'm going to leave that as is. I'm not even going to add another color to it. I think it's just fine the way that it is. So let's bring in one of the black 4x6 index cards and start picking up. Well, let's smear this and start picking up some of the rows. Now I'm making a mess on the back of the tag with my fingers because I didn't get a chance to wipe them off that well. Now ordinarily I would probably spread these colors out a little bit more. I mean, I need to keep it within the frame so that you can see it. So it's a little bit tighter here than it ordinarily would be. But you can see how cool this is. Again, lots of really fun texture. If I think that this is not a dense enough layer of color, I could come back with a brush. Here's the thing. You can do anything that you want. There are no art police that say, oh no, you can't do that. If you are inspired to try it, then why the heck not? So, as I did say earlier, a lot of times I'll come back and I'll miss this if I'm working on it, but I'm almost done here, so for now I'm not going to worry about that. But what I will do is show you how, if I wanted to, and I'm going to ignore this, I'm going to get this out of here because it's still pretty thick, there's a fair amount of it. Now what I can do is come in and miss this, and I can get this wet enough, so now it's going to leave a completely different kind of texture on my surfaces. So now you can see that you get this. The only way to get this is with something wet, and you kind of twist a little bit, and then it lifts up and it makes those marks. I think it's really, really cool like that. Now this one did get pretty well covered, so let's just grab something else here. Let's grab another index card. Excuse me. Another number 8 tag. And again, I like that the way that it is. I'm not feeling compelled to cover that anymore. So here's something that you can do. I can bring this one back in. It's got a lot of gray down here, and there is some pink, but it's not showing up a lot. So I can pick up some of this and change the entire complexion of this tag by adding these layers over the top. And now I've combined that, and I really like the way that this looks. So, glitter. Here's the thing, because you can't have too much glitter. Let me just kind of smush this out of the way so that there's a clean enough place to work here. So most of this paint, because I just put it on, is still fresh enough that if I want to put some glitter on it, I can. This one is named Peacock Satin. It's going to work in with the turquoise that's on there. So I'm just going to go ahead and sprinkle a little bit on here. How much to use? Well, what makes you happy? How much do you want to use? That's entirely up to you. It's a kind of a personal preference thing. And that's all there is to it. I kind of do this to just set the glitter down into the paint. If you want to tap it with your fingers, you can. Now, ordinarily, I would get the paint on this and then put some glitter on. You can see that this is skinned over enough that it's probably not going to stick. But if you do it and you have your glitter to one side and you just have to reach for it, when you get through adding paint to an index card, it's a really simple matter to just sprinkle some of the glitter on. And there are some amazing colors in this sparkle shaker line. This is just a few of them here. There's a whole wealth of them that are going to look great with the colors in the Prima Redesign chalk paste line. As I mentioned a few moments ago, the paint dries to a really flat finish and sprays don't bead up on it. So this is a dilutions ink spray. This is actually one that I have thinned out with a little bit of water. This is one of our masks whose name I absolutely cannot remember, and this is one of the tags that I did a little bit earlier. So all I'm going to do, and actually let me get another one here so that I can go ahead and print this off afterward. So all I'm going to do is spray lightly through the openings here a little bit, and you can see, let me wipe this up, there's no beading up going on here, which I think is just amazing. That stays nice and flat. You get the design, you get the color, and no beading up. And I think that that's great. So then if I want to just come in here with what's left on here, let's see if I can see where it is, and just go ahead and print this, I can do that too. Now I'm not going to get much because I didn't spray a ton through the openings of the stencil, but there's just enough going on there a little bit just to add some texture and some pattern. I think there might be a little bit left right there. So it's just enough to add a little bit without overwhelming it, and what I think is the most remarkable thing is that the sprays don't bead up. So there's that. Now another option for adding texture to your pages is with foam stamps. So let's bring in this because I really like this page. And then let's bring in this one, which is actually now dry. This is the one that I did where I watered down the paint that was left when I did the wrinkle-free technique. And I really like the way that this looks. So I'm going to use foam stamps. And if I bring in the journal and a tag, so here is a tag that I did. This is Kat Kerr's Grunge Round foam stamp that she designed for us. And there are a couple of others in here someplace. This is our Blossom stamp. I'm going to show you that one. And this is our Loopy Border stamp that looks like this. So that's how you get this design. These work really, really well. One of the things that I think is the most interesting is that when you work on a black background and you stamp with text, especially in black on it, you get, it almost looks like you painted around the letters, not like they were stamped. You get this positive and negative kind of illusion thing that happens that I think is really, really great. So this is Kat's stamp, and the name of it is Listen. Working with this stuff is super easy. Let's get this out of the way. So the color that's in here is called, I think it's Iron Gate. What did I do with the lid? Here it is. Yep, it's Iron Gate. So I'm going to put some out, and then I'm going to pick my brayer up again. I'm going to brayer the paint on to the stamp that way. Let's get this back over here and out of the way. All right, so here's my handy dandy brayer. Hasn't even been cleaned since the last time. Now this time, because I want, unless I'm looking for a really sketchy impression, which I'm not right now, I'm gonna go ahead and I'm going to ink up the brayer and then the stamp so that I get a nice coat of coverage over it. For this one, I think I'm going to do over most of the 4x6 index card, so I'm going to get a fairly good coat of paint on here. All right, I think that's probably enough. So I'm just going to come along. Let's do it on here. And I'm going to press this on. Lift it up. And how cool is that? You can still see the glitter where it's there in the background, but you get the impression of the stamp. So that is Kat's Grunge Rounds stamp. I slide that out of the way and I bring this one in. This is our Blossom stamp. I mentioned that. I had used it on one of the pages that's already bound into the journal. Again, because these are big stamps, I'm not going to use the entire stamp. I'm just going to do part of it. So I'm going to ink up the stamp with my brayer, and then I'm going to bring in, actually, I think I'm going to bring in this right here, and I'm going to come in and do about half of this as well. And you see how amazingly well that works. This Iron Gate is actually a pretty close black match to the black color of the index cards and the tags. It works really, really well. Now, nothing says that you can only or should only stamp in black. In fact, you can see that this is Kat's. It's called Sun Circle, which is here somewhere. And I went ahead and I used white with this. So the sky's the limit with these. You can use any of the colors that you want. It doesn't have to be black. It doesn't have to be white. But you get a really nice effect when you use this. So once all of my pages are done, and typically, obviously, I'm going to do both sides first. These ones that we just did a few minutes ago are only done on one side. But nevertheless, once both sides are done, it's time to go ahead and bind it into a journal. And for that, I use masking tape. And I'm going to, in one second, I'll show you how easy that is to do. When I'm going to bind single pages like this together with masking tape, I like to use this 2-inch wide stuff. The reason is because it allows me the opportunity to tear this so I can get away from this perfectly straight edge, but it leaves me a piece that's wide enough to actually be effective as a binding. So I'm just going to do this in all one length. You can certainly do shorter pieces if you want. This is more than enough. And all I want to do is just go ahead and grab and pull that down and then do the same kind of thing over here. Now, I like the way that this looks much better. If I think that this is a little bit too wide, I could always tear it again a little bit. So the first step is to take two elements, whether it's a tag and a page or two tags, whatever, and you put one piece of tape along the edge. If I turn this over, you can see that there's just a little tiny gap here. That's just enough to allow the page to fold. So you run the tape down, you press it in place, you trim the top, you trim the bottom, and I trim this little notch out because of the shape of the tag. Then you're ready to go ahead and add your next page. And eventually what will happen is you'll get a journal that's like this, and well, you no longer can kind of tape them side to side. So what I do instead is I will add tape to one side, like I'm going, let's make sure we're here, the correct way. Okay, so I'm going to add tape here like this. Just go ahead and press it in place. And then I'll flip this over and then go ahead and line this one up here, bearing in mind that I want to leave myself that little teeny gap. Again, just go ahead and press it in place. Grab the scissors and trim it away. That's how simple it is. This is not rocket science, folks. It's really easy to do. I know you can do this too, and I know that you can be really successful with it. So I first saw Dee Dee Catron do this. She was using narrower tape, but I thought that it was such a great idea. It makes binding so easy. This tape that we have is marketed under the Art Alternatives name, and you can see that it's reasonably translucent. So I kind of like the way that that looks. It allows a little bit to show through from the underneath. Like I'm not losing the word listen here, even though I covered it with tape. And then if you want to doodle on these or add paint to these, you could do that ahead of time if you wanted, or you just can come in and make it another design element. So when you have a page that's smaller, all you have to do, let's find one here, all you have to do is just make the tape long enough or as short as the shortest piece, if you will. Really super easy, very simple, very effective technique, and I think that it just works. So that's it. That's the journal that I made using the Prima Redesign chalk paint. I think it's a chalk paste, they call it. I think it's a marvelous tool. I didn't get a chance to put it through a stencil for you, but you do it the same way that you would anything like gel medium or gesso, and it just works.